From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Ian Morris.
Hi, well, thank you. It's great to be here, and I'd like to thank the festival organizers for inviting me, and Eric Garcia for making sure I made my way to the right room, and the good people at Farrar, Straus, and Giroux who published my book and arranged the whole thing. And of course, all of you for coming here on a beautiful day on Memorial Day weekend. I was sort of worrying they're going to show up and there'll be nobody here. Everybody will be at the beach. So it's nice to see so many people. And it's nice to be in Washington again. My wife and I lived in D.C. for a year. 25 years ago. It's kind of scary how time flies. But it's nice to be back, even though this is coming at the end of a summer when I spent a lot of time traveling. And in fact, if the festival had been just 2 weeks ago, I wouldn't have been able to be here at all. A couple of weeks ago, I was in Israel. I was part of a group that went out there invited by the Yitzhak Rabin Center, where you're traveling around. And part of our travels took us to a little place called Kerem Shalom, which is on the border with the Gaza Strip. It's the last place still open where supplies and food and stuff could go into the Gaza Strip from Israel. And when we were there, there was no actual shooting going on while we were there, because obviously they wouldn't have taken us there if the people had been shooting each other. But just 48 hours before, it had been under mortar fire from the Gaza Strip, and the guys who worked there very proudly showed us their little collection of mortar bomb bits they'd been gathering up over the previous few days. And while we were out in Israel, it was this week-long trip, we got to talk to a lot of interesting people, got to talk to some very high-ranking people on the Israeli side and on the Palestinian side, and the mayor of an Arab-Israeli town, but then also we talked to quite a few soldiers in the Israel Defense Force. But one of the things that struck me a lot while we were there is that everybody we talked to had kind of the same vision in mind for what they wanted. They wanted a peaceful outcome to all the problems. They wanted to be able to live quietly and raise their families. And yet a lot of the people we talked to were very clear that the way to get to a peaceful solution was by being violent now. And we heard this from people on both sides. The way to get there was by being violent. But people seem to have a lot of trouble explaining how the violence was going to lead to the peaceful outcome. And my sense of it is, looking back over history, this is often true, that when you're living through a set of events, it's very difficult to put them into a bigger context. And you're dealing with the sort of headlines and the horrible things happening every day. It can be very hard to see how it fits into a bigger story. And that is largely why I wrote this book. What was the book called? War, What Is It Good For? That's largely why I wrote this book, to try to see if, by putting the events of the world we're living through into a larger perspective, can we make better sense of what's going on? Well, as you heard in the introduction, I take the title of my book from the Motown classic, War, What Is It Good For? The answer, as clearly a lot of people in the audience know, absolutely nothing. Now, I'm not going to start singing at you. You're safe from that. I did have an earlier career in which I did sing, but I decided I wasn't very good at that, so we stopped doing that. What I did in this book, rather than singing at anybody, was to draw on a method that I'd used in this earlier book, Why the West Rules for Now, which was to take a problem about the modern world and try to look at it in the context of the last 15, 20,000 years of history. So this is a very different sort of history. I was looking at the schedule for the other talks going on here today. Very different sort of history from most of the talks you've been hearing in this room today, if you've been here for the earlier talks. And what I try to do is put together the evidence of archaeology and history and anthropology and evolution and various other fields and see, if you put all of these things together, looking at the whole world on a big enough time scale, can you see big patterns emerging? And I think very often you can. And when you see these big patterns, very often they are really surprising, tell you not at all what you expected to find. And I think this sort of long-term history, when you're looking at the problem of war, it leads you to some particularly surprising and slightly uncomfortable conclusions. It suggests that the song got the answer at least partly wrong. To say war is good for absolutely nothing, that is not completely true. I think it also suggests, going beyond the song, it suggests that a lot of the people who are interested in ending war in the world and working toward that a lot of the people are going about it in the wrong way. So I think it is an important question. So, okay, it's a paradoxical and uncomfortable kind of claim to make. But war, when you look at the big picture, war has been good for something. And basically, it seems like across the last 15,000 years, war has been one of the major forces in making the world a safer place, which sounds very bizarre, very unlikely, but this, I think, is what the evidence points us toward. Okay, now, I'm not the first person who's ever seen this pattern in history before. And back in 1932, the League of Nations came up with this great idea. They said, let's write a letter to Albert Einstein. And let's say in this letter, we'll say, dear Professor Einstein, we would like you to write to somebody really important, your choice who, and we'd like you to ask this person a really important question. And it's your choice what the question is. And please feel free to get into a fight with this important person. So Einstein says, well, what shall I do? And he decides, I will write to Sigmund Freud. So he writes to Sigmund Freud. And he says to Freud in his letter, is there any way of delivering humanity from the menace of war? So this is Einstein's question to Freud. And Freud writes back to him. And clearly this letter that Freud writes, this is not what Einstein was expecting to get. And they begin an exchange of letters that goes on for a while. And there's an exhibit of them going on at the moment in London at the Freud Museum. But Freud writes back this long letter. And at one point in the letter, he says to Einstein, paradoxical as it sounds, we must admit that warfare well might serve to pave the way to that unbroken peace we so desire. Freud, I think, saw basically the same thing I saw when I looked at long-term history, that war seems to play a part in creating peace. And Freud, I think, was right in saying this. But when Freud was saying it back 70-odd years ago, we really didn't have much evidence. Now I think we've got a lot more evidence to see how all of this works. So, okay, what I want to do then in the time I've got left, I want to talk a little bit about the claims I make in this book. It seems to me there are four things we have to understand to see how war has functioned in long-term world history. I'm actually going to talk about three of them, otherwise we'll be here all night, and I assume nobody wants that. So I'm going to talk about the three main claims I try to make in my book, go through each of them in turn, and then just say a few words at the end by way of conclusion to pull it all together. So, okay, the first of these claims, the biggest one, the most important one for the book, is this idea that by fighting wars, people have created larger, more organized societies that have reduced the risk that their members are going to die violently. I think this is kind of one of the very, very biggest things that's happened in human history. But to see it happening, you've got to go back a long way. You've got to look at the whole world across the last 10,000 years or so. And if you do that, like say if we could time machine ourselves back 10,000 years to the later phases of the Stone Age, what you would find is that nearly everybody in the world 10,000 years ago lives in very small society. Actually, am I going too fast for the signing? I drank way too much coffee today. Nearly everybody in the world lived in very small groups. Typically, like a dozen or so people is the group you'll live in. You're moving around all the time. And you live in these groups, they have very little internal structure. There's no police force or anything like that. People get into arguments, as people do, and they've got all kinds of ways to resolve the arguments, but one of the ways to settle your arguments, then as now, is by force. And then, though, there's just a lot less to prevent you using force to settle your arguments. And at one time, 100 years ago, anthropologists used to paint this picture of the Stone Age. It was like you wake up in the morning and the first thing you do is kill somebody, and then you have your breakfast and you kill somebody else. And obviously this is completely wrong. These people were not savages. But relatively few structures in place to settle disputes. If you live in a band, say a dozen people, if one person in that band is murdered, dies violently every generation, that gives you a rate of violent death approaching 10%, roughly 1 in 10 chance that any person is going to die violently. And this is roughly what the evidence seems to suggest. In Stone Age societies, your chance of dying violently is in the 10 to 20% range, which, I mean, I have no idea how many people there are in this room, lots and lots. But I think like 1 in 5 or 1 in 10 of us would die violently if we lived in a Stone Age society. That's a fairly stunning number, if it's right. Well, say we fast forward now to the 20th century AD, which is a time, as we all know, a time of great violence and bloodiness. Two world wars are fought, genocides are committed, nuclear weapons are used in anger. Something in the region of 100 million to 200 million people die violently during the 20th century, an astronomical number. But something like 10 billion, with a B, people live during the 20th century. That's a 1 to 2% rate of violent death. Violent death, and again, if the numbers are right, rates of violent death had fallen by 90% from the Stone Age to the 20th century AD. And according to the World Health Organization, in the 21st century, it's down to 0.7%, even lower. And I'm sure some of you will have read Steven Pinker's book, The Better Angels of Our Nature, where he does a great job of pulling together a lot of this material to document this decline in rates of violent death. Now, this is a really surprising statistic. I think a lot of us have trouble accepting that the world can be so much safer now than it was in prehistoric times. Surprising statistic. But the explanation for it, I think, is more surprising still. The explanation seems to be that starting about 10,000 years ago, in some parts of the world, when two groups go to war with each other, the winners start absorbing the losers into a single larger society. And this, you know, rise of great ancient empires, all this sort of thing. Winners start absorbing the losers of the wars. Now, the reason that's important for this story is, like, you know, imagine you are the ruler now of one of these societies. You've beaten up your neighbors. You've absorbed them into your society. What do you want from all these people? Well, if you're a ruler with any sense, what you don't want is for all your subjects to get up every morning and start killing each other. That's the worst possible thing. What you generally want if you're a ruler is you want these people to get up in the morning, go and work in their fields, and hand over money to you, pay their taxes. When they fight with their neighbors, you don't want them killing each other and burning each other's farms down. You want them to go to the judges and the law courts and resolve things peacefully so there is more revenue being produced so that you, the ruler, can get more revenue and spend it on virgins in your harem or baths full of mare's milk or whatever it is you happen to want as a ruler. That is what you want. So these pressures develop on the rulers to prevent their subjects from killing each other, which over the long run, this is what the rulers proceed to do. You're not because the rulers are angels. I mean, the rulers are politicians, and you mostly live in Washington, D.C., so I need say no more on the subject of what kind of people these politicians are. But those are the sort of guys who are in charge. They are self-interested and ruthless thugs on the whole. But if you are a self, with no contemporary allusion at all, if you are a self-interested, ruthless thug, if you can persuade your subjects to work quietly and pay taxes, you are likely to flourish. Whereas the neighboring self-interested, ruthless thug, if he allows them to run around wild, he will not flourish. You are likely to push him out of his job. You can kill him or whatever. He'll be overthrown. All kinds of possibilities. But the long-term effect is this: rulers moving toward trying to pacify the societies that they rule. Now, probably you're thinking of all kinds of exceptions to this. It's very easy to think of guys who do not fit this big story. And in my book, I refer to this as the "what about Hitler" problem. Or you can substitute the mad dictator of your choice. What about Mao? What about Idi Amin? There is no end of these guys. Except that actually there is an end to these guys. There's lots of these guys who behave in completely irrational ways, and on the whole, they don't flourish. Hitler does not flourish. There are lots and lots of wars that don't lead to larger, safer societies being formed. Lots and lots of rulers who don't follow this sort of set of rules. And yet, overall, the long-term effect is societies do move toward being safer. Rulers do succeed in reducing violence. And after I published the book, I was going around talking about it back in the spring, and one of my talks took me to Kansas City, and we went out for dinner after, and was chatting with the guys who'd organized this thing, and we were talking about Harry S. Truman. And I realized, unfortunately, this was after I'd published the book, but I realized that that is the name for this process. It should be called Truman's Law. Because Harry S. Truman, very famously, was once asked, "Mr. Truman, what makes for a great president?" And he says, "A great president is one who is right 51% of the time." And that, I think, is how this process works. It's not like every war pushes the world toward larger, safer societies. Many, many, many don't. But just enough do that this is the direction that the world moves in. And across 10,000 years, the result is a 90% fall in rates of violent death. It's like war makes states and states make peace. This is, the basic bottom line here. And again, I'm hardly the first person to see this. Back in the 17th century, Thomas Hobbes wrote this famous book, Leviathan, where this was his basic point. He says, left to our own devices, all we will do is run around killing each other. The life of man will be nasty, poor, brutish, and short. What prevents that, he says, Leviathan. And Leviathan is a really scary monster in the book of Job in the Bible. And Hobbes's point is that governments as scary as Leviathan will scare the people straight. That, says Hobbes, is the only way to make a safe and prosperous world. And Hobbes, a bit like Freud, Hobbes got to that conclusion just by reasoning about the way the world works. Now, though, I think we have evidence. So, okay, that's my first claim in my book, the biggest claim, that war produced these states which produce internal peace and drive down rates of violent death. Second claim, war is clearly the worst possible way we could do this, making these states and making peace. And yet it seems to be pretty much the only way we've found. And that, I think, is a really depressing conclusion to reach. In the song, War, What Is It Good For?, Edwin Starr says at one point, Lord knows there's got to be a better way. But apparently there is not. This, I think, is what we learn from history. People only give up their freedoms, on the whole, when they're forced into doing so. Now, lots of people don't like that conclusion. As I discovered when I wrote an article about it for the Washington Post, in fact, lots of people did not like that conclusion. But it seems to me that when you look at the evidence, the reason that rates of violent death have fallen so much is because people fought wars and created leviathans. And the reason rates of violent death have sort of accelerated the decline in the last couple of hundred years is that we've gone from leviathans to sort of super leviathans, globocops, if you like. A couple of cases, the British Empire in the 19th century, the United States in recent times, that have been able to act kind of like a leviathan for the whole planet and to deter governments from using force to do what they want. So this, I would say, this has been the major force driving the pacification of the world. Okay, so if those two claims are true, then I think we do have to conclude that war has been good for something. It's indirectly made the world a safer place. So good, in fact, that the third of the claims I make is that war is now, in a sense, putting itself out of business. And in spite of the, obviously it hasn't done so completely, otherwise I would not have seen what I saw down at the Gaza Strip a couple of weeks ago. But we've entered a world now where the weapons are so destructive, organizations so effective, that we can't wage any more great wars. So, okay, so those are the three claims I make in the book, that wars led to the formation of these leviathans, which pacified societies. Fighting war seems to be pretty much the only way people have figured out to do that. And the end result of that is that war is sort of beginning to put itself out of business. And then the book, I try to tell this story across the last 15,000 years, looking at some of these countless wars that have been fought. But I think an obvious question to ask. I mean, if, say, for the sake of argument, we assume I am completely right about everything, which I think is always a good assumption, but if we assume that, obvious question, why? Why does history work in this unpleasant way? I mean, the story, in a way, is a happy one. The world is becoming safer. There's many reasons to think this will continue. Why does it have to work in this very, very unpleasant way? And I think to answer that, you have to go beyond even this sort of 15,000 year long-term history that I like to do and ask questions on the scale of biological evolution, looking at the history of life across the last 3.5 billion years. Then I think the explanation for why this happens, then I think it starts to become a lot clearer. Under the biological evolution of violence, this is a field that's seen enormous advances in the last 50 years. So I just want to talk about this for a little minute because I think it does help us understand the why part of this question. Why did stuff work in this kind of way? And biologists, I discovered to my to my cost. One time I was one of the deans at Stanford University, in charge of trying to tell academics what to do, which is just an impossible task. But so I had some dealings with the biology department. Biologists are even worse than historians for being unable to agree on anything at all. I mean, they're just the most chaotic group of people. But over the last 50 years or so, one thing increasingly the biologists do seem to be agreeing on is that violence is an evolved adaptation. And what they mean by that is pretty much any species of animals you look at in the world uses violence in some way to settle disputes. And of course, every species is different. And obviously, you know, lions and lambs, say, two good examples. Lions and lambs use violence, use different amounts of violence in different ways to achieve different results. And yet, pretty much every species, us included, uses violence in some way. Pretty much every species, you can say, each species has a sort of equilibrium amount of violence that they've evolved towards. So, you know, lions tend to use so much violence, lambs so much violence. But every species is different. And within every species, every single individual animal is different from each other in how much violence they use. But the result, the sort of product of all these different amounts and predispositions to be violent, the result of this tends to be each species has its own equilibrium amount of violence it uses. And so, like, say, I mean, say with the lions, you know, lions famously tend to be kind of pretty violent animals. But say, I mean, say, this gentleman in the second row here, say you are a lion, and you are not just any old lion, though. You are a particularly aggressive lion. And your lions think that many problems can be solved by biting and scratching. But you think every problem can be solved by biting and scratching. Now, what's going to happen to you? Is this going to go well for you? No, this is not going to go very well for you. If you use too much violence and too much determined relative to the equilibrium, the kind of ideal balance for your species, too much violence, you will drop out of the gene pool relatively quickly. You'll get injured, you'll get killed, whatever. You will drop out of the gene pool. You're less likely to pass your genes on to the next generation. Say, on the other hand, you're not you. Say a gentleman sitting just to your left here, you're another lion. But you now, you are the exact opposite. You are kind of a pacifist lion. You think force solves no problems. And you sort of sit around, you stay out of all the fights. Is this going to go well for you? No, this is not going to go well for you. You're going to get shoved aside in the fight for food, shoved aside in the fight for mates. You two are less likely than average to pass your genes on to the next generation. And it may be that there's no perfect, exact average lion. But the outcome of all these million, well, not millions anymore, sadly, but all these thousands of separate lions doing their own thing is a kind of equilibrium amount of violence for lions. And they've evolved toward that equilibrium point. And if their environment changes, say a new form of prey comes in or a new predator or whatever comes in, then the equilibrium will shift and lions will evolve biologically toward a different equilibrium point. All animal species, us included, we all do this. And in this way, we are exactly like every other species of animal in the world. Except for this one point that we are actually completely different from every other species of animal in the world. Because what's happened with us is that biological evolution has given us these gigantic brains, which no other animal has anything quite like the big brain we've got. And so, like with us, if our world changes dramatically, we will begin to evolve biologically into a new kind of animal, as of course we did in the past to get here. But we are also, because of the big brains, we are able to evolve culturally. And we can change our institutions, we can change our cultures, we can change our values. And we have done this. We can see this from the historical record. We can change the way we do things. So if the payoffs from using violence change, we can decide to use violence in different ways. And really, no other species of animal is able to do that. This is why our rate of violent death has fallen by 90% across the last 10,000 years. Even though we're still basically the same animals we were 10,000 years ago, we've evolved biologically a bit, but not very much. Yet our rate of violent death has fallen by 90%. This is unique in the entire history of the planet, so far as we know. And the reason for it seems to be that our wars created these larger Leviathan states that raise the costs from using violence, because now the police are going to show up and they are going to shoot you dead if you use violence too much. Raise the costs. We've responded responded, well, we respond to that a little bit biologically, by more genetically peaceful people will tend to have more children. But we've responded much faster culturally by changing the ways that we behave. Our societies have become less violent because we've responded to new sets of payoffs. And what I think this tells us, when we look at the human story in the larger biological framework, is we can't wish war out of existence. It just doesn't work that way. But the good news is that we do respond really well to changes in our environment. And I think the big lesson of our history is that over the last 10,000 years, what has changed the environment has been the rise of these strong governments, making, and more recently the Globocops, making the payoffs from violence lower. It's scaring us straight, basically. So, okay, that's the big argument I make in the book. And at the end of the book, I turn a little bit to say the so what question. Well, that is all fine and dandy, 10, 15,000 years of history, but so what? Does this really tell us something useful about the world? And I think it does. I think it explains how we've gotten to this world that is so much more peaceful than it used to be in the past. And it gives us some hints of how going forward we might continue this trend toward a less violent world. But it also, I think, suggested it's not all smiles. There are some rather worrying things facing us in the 21st century. One of the things I think is most worrying is that the world we live in now is one where the United States, I mean, the US doesn't rule the world, very obviously, but the US kind of oversees a global system. It's the most integrated situation the world has ever known in its history. And it's also got the lowest rate of violent death the world has ever known in its history. And the US, despite what's happening in the Gaza Strip, the US kind of oversees this, functioning as a globocop, raising the likely costs of using violence for other states. And hopefully, though, this will continue and rates of violent death will continue falling towards zero. But being a historian, what I like to do is look and see, can we see comparable examples in the past? And there is one analogy, which is, a slightly alarming one. And this is the analogy of the only other globocop the world has ever really had, which was the British Empire in the 19th century. The British oversaw a similar but much weaker international system. And in the 19th century, that world was more integrated than it had ever been before. Rates of violent death were lower than they'd ever been before. But a rather scary thing started happening as the 19th century went on. The British start to be aware of this by the 1870s. Basically, the more successful they are at creating an integrated world from which Britain profits mightily, the more they find themselves undermining their own global order. The only way to make this global order run for the British Empire was by helping their trading partners enrich themselves so they could be part of the system. And by the 1870s, it's becoming clear that some countries, the US is the major one, but also Germany, Japan, a few others, are getting so rich and so powerful that it's no longer obvious that they see the British as a globocop anymore. And as I say, by the 1870s, this is beginning to become clear. By the 1910s, you've got to the point where there is no certainty anymore in the councils of the world that Britain really is a globocop and really can use its force to do anything. 104 years ago from today, of course, Germany decides it's worth taking a chance on using violence to settle its problems, with catastrophic results for everybody involved. Now, a lot of people have pointed out the situation of the US today is in some way, in some ways very different, but in some ways some alarming similarities. The US, again, running this global system, deterring the use of force from other powers, and yet it seems that the more successful the US is in running this global system, the more it creates potential rivals. And of course, the one people tend to look at today very much is China. And there's no obvious necessary reason why the US and China should come into conflict, just as there was no obvious and necessary reason 100 years ago why Britain and Germany should have come into conflict. And yet, that was what happened. The lesson of the British example seems to be that the weaker the globocop becomes, the greater the risk grows of someone deciding to take a chance on force. The more often other governments do that, the more you spin the wheel, the more chance, the more risk you face of things sliding into catastrophe. Now, what this suggests, if this is a good analogy, is that the next 40 years or so, the 2010s through the 2040s, might be just as unstable as the 1870s to 1910s were. But this time, of course, it'd be like the run-up to the First World War, but with weapons even more terrible than those of the Cold War. And that, I think, is a rather scary scenario. I mean, if that analogy is a good one, then the next 40 years might end up being the most dangerous ones in history. So, okay, to wrap up then. The obvious implication, although, as I say, this is not one that everybody I discovered likes to hear. My book originally came out in German before it came out in English. I went to Germany talking about the book first, and they really did not like this implication. But the implication seems to be, if you want a safer world, support the US in its role as Globocop. And that, it seems to me, that is all there is to it when you look for the lessons of history. As I say, I was in Germany. It was right during that week. That was when it came out that the NSA had been tapped Angela Merkel's cell phone. A lot of people seem to feel I was personally responsible for this, even though I have trouble making my own cell phone work at all. But anyway, that it seems to me is the implication of long-term history. Obviously, you know, a lot of people who are professionally engaged in trying to promote peace in the world have drawn the exact opposite conclusion. So I think, you know, if I'm right about this, then this is a significant conclusion to reach. I saw in the newspaper this morning, a new Pew poll just came out saying 54% of Americans now feel that the government should be acting more forcefully in international affairs. So clearly I'm not the only person who's drawing this conclusion. But to end on another cheerful note, even if the US avoids rerunning the kind of tape of history that the British Empire faced at the end of the 19th century, even if the US survives the next 40 years as the great global power overseeing a system that produces an increasingly peaceful world, can that go on forever? I mean, is it plausible to suggest we've reached a state where there will just never again be violent conflict in the world? Well, nothing has ever gone on forever so far. So it seems to be a little bit optimistic, Pollyanna-ish, to suggest, well, yeah, this is going to go on forever and ever. Things will just gradually get better. When my book came out in Britain, I went to Britain, and in Britain, as you might know, people are obsessed with the anniversary of World War I. The BBC has commissioned 4 years of World War I shows. People are going to be shooting themselves well before we get to 2018. But you're British obsessed with 1914. And so I said to the audiences I was talking to, well, imagine for a moment, imagine Britain avoids getting into World War I and doesn't go through all of that. Do you really think that here in 2014, Britain would still be running the global order? And I mean, I don't know how many people I talked to. It was quite a lot of people in the course of a week. Not a single one thought Britain would actually still be running the world. And so I think it's very unlikely to suggest that other things will simply be equal and that the current global order can carry on forever. Does that mean that we're all doomed? We're doomed to a sort of nuclear rerun of 1914? Well, I have some thoughts on that too, but I think I'm pretty much out of time. So for those, you're going to have to read my book. So thank you very much. Thank you.
Question?
So, do I just call on whoever I... Oh, okay. Well, I think the gentleman over here was okay. First to Mike.
Are you really saying, in effect, that soft power is effective only if hard power is viable?
Yeah. Can everybody hear the questions? It's a huge one. You can all... Okay, I'll take that as agreement. Yes. Now, this was something that surprised me a little bit as I was writing the book, because I'd not given enough thought to this before. But this, I think, you suggest here, is soft power only really a viable force in the world if hard power is already there? And I got to say, my conclusion would be, yes, it is, which is not what I expected. But, I mean, like, say, you look back to ancient times, the Roman Empire, Han Dynasty, China, the two great powers in the world 2,000 years ago, both of them enormously effective soft power, persuading people to want to be part of their world orders, Romanization, sinification, major processes, both of them, soft power follows the exercise of hard power. This is what I felt I learned from world history, which again is a slightly depressing conclusion, but I think it is the case. And gentleman over here.
Yes, have you heard of the book, The Chalice and the Blade by Rianne Eisler?
I have, but I haven't read it. And I assume you're now going to tell me how it disproves everything I just said.
Well, it certainly would challenge some of it. It's talking about prehistory, which certainly within the realm of recorded history, mm-hmm. a lot of what you say makes sense. But in looking at prehistory, essentially there was an examination of the archaeological evidence, seeing that there was, through a different lens, which we make all kinds of assumptions when we do our archaeological work, that through a different lens, part of the archaeology they examined showed that there were some civilizations where collaboration, cooperation were possible. In a sense, a Garden of Eden mm-hmm. compared to violence that you're speaking of. And so it makes me wonder whether that's a possible thing to look for and to try to build as far as trying to find a way that we could raise people in such a way that through ostracism and group work with each other, peer pressure and so forth, that we would avoid violent confrontations and find ways to get along and work together.
Well, thank you. That sounds like another book I need to add to the list to read. But yeah, and actually, I should say, though, when you give you a 25-minute talk like this, because you have to present the points, boom, 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 this happened, then this happened. All of the points in this narrative are intensely debated, especially the archaeological stuff. So my background is mostly in archaeology. There's nothing I love more than digging holes and finding things in the bottom of them. But yet everything is intensely debated. Well, thank you for the question. Gentleman over here.
Thank you very much for your talk. I was wondering about the impact of two phenomena on what you've had to say. A, technology, and in the near term, nuclear weapons. You know, mm-hmm. what if there hadn't been nuclear weapons? And then second, looking forward, the increasing devolution of power away from the nation state toward non-state actors, super-empowered individuals, failed mm-hmm. states, that sort of thing.
Yeah, a couple of great questions. I think the technological story is obviously a major part of this. And particularly because the important things happened in recent time has been the invention of nuclear weapons, which while we're in a world where we had two superpowers with the force to arguably to destroy life altogether in the 1980s, that was a major disincentive to everybody from doing anything that would scare the other side too much. And out at Stanford, we have a lot of nuclear strategy people. And one of the things they worry about, they say the world we live in now is, they say the Cold War was scary but simple. Scary because we could all die at a moment's notice. Simple because there are two superpowers and the rules for how to engage each other are fairly clear. The world we live in now, though, is not as scary but much less simple, they say. We don't have enough nuclear weapons left to kill anybody. For every nuclear warhead in the world in 1986, there's now one. So this is really good. But we still got enough to kill at least a couple of 100 million people at one go, and who knows where that would lead us. And the problem now, of course, is we don't have a real international mutual assured destruction set up. It sounds insane to say it, but that is the problem. There are people who think they can use nuclear weapons, and that is what makes it all scary. But the technology thing, I spend a lot of time in the last chapter of the book talking about where some of the technological changes are taking us, because that, I think, is going to be the real game changer. And why I'm actually very optimistic about where the story is taking us. Thank you.
The neoconservative thinker Francis Fukuyama wrote a book called. Francis Fukuyama's End of History, which, very briefly, uses Hegel's philosophy to a dialectic to show that we live in an increasingly rational world, and with the global integration of the world economy, the interdependence of the mega corporations and so forth, that it just doesn't make much sense to have international conflict and so forth. Unfortunately, this was written in 1989, right before the outbreak of all these wars. But by the end of history, he meant that there would be no major conflict, world cataclysms or conflagrations. This was actually influential. They said this first time Hegel's name was ever mentioned in the halls of Congress in philosophy. So I was wondering what you think of that.
Yes, a great question. Frank Fukuyama is a colleague of mine at Stanford. He's a great guy, very, very nice guy. And of course, a very famous writer as well. And in that book, The End of History and the Last Man, part of his thesis is we've now entered this post-historical period with the fall of the Berlin Wall. And we're moving into a more rational society where use of violence to settle problems is just going to be much less prevalent. And I guess what I feel about this, and a number of other similar arguments out there as well, is that this, I would say this is a very good analysis of the world we've been living in the last 50, 60 years, certainly the world we've been living in since 1989. In a world where you've got a stable deterrence system in place, whether that is a band of chimpanzees with a clear leader or the modern post-Soviet world, violence tends to drop sharply. And I think the growth of a lot of the institutions that we now see, and actually this comes back to the last question as well, the non-state institutions that have produced so much more peaceful interchange, that is something which only happens when you've got somebody able to provide the overall security system. And the reason I say that is that when you look at long-term history, you see something very, very similar in the Roman Empire and in the Han Dynasty of China 2,000 years ago. You get great empires built up with very powerful forces at the center, able to enforce law. If somebody off in Gaul or Sichuan pops up and starts making trouble, the emperor goes out and whacks them. And people know this is going to happen, so they don't cause trouble all that much. In a world where resort to arms is very unlikely to get you what you want, people work much harder at peaceful ways of getting what they want. And that, I would say, what I feel I've learned from history is that explains what we've seen in the last 30, 40 years with the proliferation of NGOs, organizations above the level of the state and below the level of the state. So, yeah, I mean, I think Frank was absolutely right about this, but I also think there's a bigger context it has to be put in.
In the short run of American history, every war in which Americans were deeply engaged seems to have been followed by a burst of liberalism. The Revolutionary War led to the creation of the most democratic nation republics, state republics we had seen. The Civil War led to the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments. World War II, we came out of it, and we were on our road to Jackie Robinson and Brown versus the Board of Education. Perhaps because each of those wars is fought articulating liberal goals or purposes. But when you look a little further, do you see anything like that in the preceding 10,000 years?
Yeah. That's a really interesting thing to think about. And I think part of the answer has to be the way that modern wars have been fought. Because some people would sort of generalize it beyond just the US and say that on the whole, the societies in recent times that have fought and won big wars tend to go through very liberal periods after. The ones that lose big wars often don't. And I think one reason for that is in order to fight and win these wars, modern wars, you have to mobilize vast numbers of people and get them to agree to go into uniform, pay much higher taxes, all kinds of things. You've got to get this social consensus behind the war. If you don't do that, then you're very, unless you're just really lucky, you're very unlikely to win. And so, I mean, like, sure, many of you will have seen this new book by Thomas Piketty, Capital in the 21st Century. Piketty, in that book, is interested in why wealth inequality has increased within nations so much in the last few years. And his argument is that this is sort of built into the logic of capitalism as you get this widening gap between rich and poor. The only thing that's ever turned it around, he says, was the Great World Wars, that the governments had to make these deals with the mass of the population to get them to fight against Hitler, against Kaiser Wilhelm. And the result of that is you get these long periods, 30 plus years after the wars, when you've got these very progressive tax rates in place, all kinds of things that basically promote liberal ends. And his rather gloomy, one of his rather gloomy conclusions, he's full of gloomy conclusions, his rather gloomy conclusion is we should expect the sort of liberal period to be coming to an end and be rolled back unless dramatic action is taken. So yeah, I suspect that you're absolutely right about that. Oh, so we have one more question.
Yes, the question is, what is your reaction to worsening of global environmental trends and climate destabilization in terms of actually reversing the violent death rate? So we're at 7 billion people now. If that goes to 10 billion by 2050, at the same time, land and oceans lose fertility. And then are we headed towards a total reversal in the next, in this century?
Yeah, wow. Well, let me give you a really hopeless answer to that. I think it all depends. Because these problems that you're talking about, the challenge, you know, say, for somebody looking at it from a security point of view, the challenge is, are these problems going to destabilize relations within and between nations to the point that people start to feel the only solution to their problems is to use violence? And whether that happens depends on an awful lot of other things. Like, say, I mean, I mentioned at the beginning I was in Israel last week, and they now get some, I forget the numbers, this insane proportion of their water now comes from desalinization, which even a couple of decades ago, this was too expensive even to consider. And yet now they are able, they're desalinating vast amounts of the Mediterranean. They're selling fresh water to their neighbors because of this. So I would say it all depends on what happens. I mean, if, say, one of the things climate change analysts always point out is that climate change impacts different parts of the world in different ways. The worst impacts seem to be in the most unstable parts of the world, like the Middle East, Central Africa, Central Asia. If environmental degradation accelerates faster than people are able to find ways to deal with it, then I think we should expect the likelihood of violence to go up and up. If, on the other hand, there people do find ways to deal with it, then we might be able to deal. We might be able to prevent it going that way. I mean, like if just to sort of close, I mean, if we'd been having this conversation 100 years ago, and you'd said to me, well, you know, some doom and gloom merchants are saying the population of the world will quadruple in the next 100 years. Surely we'll all kill each other. If I'd said, hey, don't worry, because the food supply will quintuple, everything will be great, you would have thought I was insane. And yet that, of course, is exactly what happened. Although we did have two world wars along the way, which is a slight problem. But I guess I should stop there. So thank you very much for coming on.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.